Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Kaz Hirai.
Good morning and welcome to the E3 2004 pre-show festivities. It's great to be here with all of you today as this year marks the 10th year anniversary of E3. It's really hard to believe that 10 years has gone by since the first E3 trade show. And interestingly enough, our history as a company parallels the first show in 1995, as it was there that we debuted the original PlayStation in North America. And E3 remains just as exciting now as it was in years past. As E3 has grown over the years, so has our market. We have reached new heights that no one could have imagined. And even more incredible, we have built this business of massive proportions on a global scale. And as a testament to this reach, Sony Computer Entertainment has shipped more than 170 million units of hardware and more than 1.5 billion units of software, which in my mind is a pretty amazing accomplishment. Looking back, there have been many constants since the beginning of the PlayStation. Great games that capture consumer imagination, competitors entering the market and fading away. But our focus and dedication to this category has been unwavering. A lot has changed, too. Games are more legitimate, more relevant. We broke the industry curse by leading in two consecutive hardware generations. And PlayStation is now big business, and the stakes are even higher. And we have created the first 10-year-plus hardware lifecycle to keep up with the ever-changing world of games. Today, we're here to speak to you about how we plan to evolve our business through new dimensions of PlayStation. New dimensions that will continue to propel the industry forward in the right direction and help us manage a healthy platform lifecycle for all. New dimensions that will inspire innovation and allow consumers to really connect with one another through the gaming experience. New dimensions that will take us into the mobile entertainment space for the first time. We have been talking a bit about the importance of a 10-year hardware lifecycle and why this is essential for the continued health of the industry. But why is this so important? The dynamics of our business have changed, particularly with the advent of new, more powerful hardware technology. The increase in hardware prowess allows for more sophisticated games, ultimately, but with a somewhat extended development lifecycle. As consumer tastes have changed, so have their expectations. And we have found that our consumers are spending more time with our type of entertainment, and they are adding more and more titles to their game libraries. So we owe it to the development community and to our consumers to build long, sustainable platform life cycles. Not only do we view this as an imperative for the future and health of our industry, but we also believe it as our responsibility as the platform holder to help bolster continued innovation within each generation. So, where are we on this path to future growth and development? Building a global audience is one area that only our company has been able to do and deliver for our partners. This chart outlines not only where we are with the platform today, but also the shape of our competitors from a worldwide perspective as of the end of March. As of the end of our fiscal year, Sony Computer Entertainment shipped more than 71 million PlayStation 2 units worldwide, which ends up being more than 5 times that of our closest competitor. And we have been fortunate to have software support on PlayStation 2 from day one, which has allowed us to push the limits of the install base, not just here in North America, but in all major markets on a global basis. And within this fiscal year, Sony Computer Entertainment will ship an additional 14.1 million PlayStation 2 units worldwide. More units in 1 year than our competitors' entire installed base. Specifically, in North America, we have seen incredible growth so far, just 42 months into the platform lifecycle. And as you can see from this chart, the total North American household penetration on PlayStation is close to 30% in 104 months on the market. Through the accelerated growth we have experienced on PlayStation 2, we have been able to hit the 20% household penetration milestone in less than half the time. And this bodes well for the future growth on PlayStation 2 and is even more reason for extending the product's life cycle beyond the conventional period. We believe that the PlayStation 2 has the potential of reaching new audiences that we haven't touched with the original PlayStation. And it is a positive message for the entire industry at large. And even with the accelerated growth on PlayStation 2, it is interesting to know that the demographic base on our two platforms is relatively the same. The age ranges between the two platforms are pretty evenly distributed, but in half the time, PlayStation 2 has reached the same level of user penetration. Considering the fact that we specifically targeted the 18 to 34-year-old audience right out of the gate, one of the things that we have found to be most interesting is the increased growth in the 13 to 17 age range on PlayStation 2. And we believe that this is an indication that more consumers are turning to gaming than ever before. All of this data helps us to really understand our current consumer base, but more importantly, it validates where we want to take the PlayStation 2 platform business now and in the years to come. We view the 2004 opportunity as really the year to cultivate the casual gaming market. Now, let me make the distinction between the mass market and the casual gaming audiences. We know that more than 25 million people have a PlayStation 2 unit in their homes. We consider this the tip of the mass market iceberg. We are now concentrating our efforts on bringing in the casual gamer while still inspiring the core audience that has been with us for years. How do we plan to do this? Through three main areas: mass market pricing, platform-defining titles, and of course, through innovation. Smart platform management requires us to take a good, hard look at pricing on both fronts, hardware and software. And as we continue to view our platform business as having a 10-year minimum life cycle, decisions on pricing, more importantly, especially strategic planning for price reductions. At Sony Computer Entertainment, we manage all hardware development and manufacturing from within. And this allows us to continuously evaluate how and when we can pass on cost efficiencies to the consumer. We launched PlayStation 2 in 2000 at the same price point, $299, as the original PlayStation, which debuted in 1995. Consumers immediately saw increased value in the PlayStation 2 proposition from both a product features and also a pricing standpoint. At $299, we almost sold 10 times the number of PlayStation 2 units versus the original PlayStation. And with this type of growth, we were able to sustain the $299 price point for almost 2 years. At $199, we sold more than 6 times the volume as compared to PlayStation. Although many of our competitors have tried to increase their position against PlayStation 2 solely based on price, we broke new ground, which allows for a lot of flexibility. Instead of pricing ourselves out of the market too early in the life cycle, there is plenty of room for growth as we start expanding our reach into the casual gaming market. Sustaining our hardware price points for longer periods, we demonstrated that we take our role as the industry leader very seriously. And as the main market driver, we know that the health of the business rests on our shoulders. So, now is the time to make the next move towards our end goal. We're here to announce today that effective immediately, PlayStation 2 is now available for $149. This price move impacts both SKUs on the market we have today, the standalone PlayStation 2 package and the PlayStation 2 combo pack, which includes a network adapter and ATV Off-Road Fury 2 along with the hardware. We're supporting our new pricing initiative with heavy marketing support now and throughout the year, beginning with an ad campaign that breaks this week on TV and through national papers. We're really excited about the $149 price point, and I'm sure that the market will respond in kind. It's a very significant move for us. It demonstrates our commitment to continuing the growth on PlayStation 2. But it was also a key milestone on the original PlayStation. And in fact, 90% of the overall volume was achieved after we had hit the $149 price point. I touched on the first essential element required to meet our 2004 goal of tapping into the casual gaming market, pricing. The second is content. The PlayStation platforms have enjoyed the most support of any gaming system in history. Not only have we had the best, most diverse game libraries, but also the best platform games, and the best games have been on the PlayStation. With the advent of CD-based hardware systems, coupled with an aggressive software pricing model that includes our greatest hits line, we have seen more million-selling units games than ever before. To date, on PlayStation, we have 72 million unit sellers in 8.5 years. On PlayStation 2, in just 3.5 years on the market, the million sellers have grown exponentially to 41 titles. This is about 7 times that of our closest competitor. In fact, 11 PlayStation 2 titles are multi-million unit sellers, which is more than the total of million unit selling games on Xbox and GameCube combined. Overall, this demonstrates that our partners not only choose PlayStation 2 as their platform of choice because of our larger user base, but also because it's the platform that offers the most opportunity for financial and commercial success. The forecast for this year's games is brighter than ever. We have a number of big ticket releases coming in 2004. Not only are we giving consumers something to look forward to through extensions of existing franchises they have come to love, we also have a number of new franchises being introduced into the market. A small sample of titles expected to be big hits on PlayStation 2 are Killzone from Guerrilla Games and Sony Computer Entertainment Europe, Gran Turismo 4 from Polyphony Digital, The Getaway, Black Monday from Sony Computer Entertainment Europe, Metal Gear Solid 3, Snake Eater from Konami, and God of War from Sony Computer Entertainment America, Santa Monica. 2004 is also the year of the platformer. All of the famed platform franchises will be making another appearance this fall, and they include Sly 2, Band of Thieves from Sucker Punch, Jak 3 from Naughty Dog, and Ratchet and Clank, Up Your Arsenal from Insomniac Games. And of course, not to be forgotten is the Grand Theft Auto franchise from Rockstar Games. One of the most significant series on PlayStation 2, we are pleased to announce that the next iteration of this franchise, Grand Theft Auto San Andreas, will be coming exclusively to PlayStation 2 this fall. We look forward with great anticipation to hearing more about this product in the months to come. Another area that we at Sony Computer Entertainment understand better than any other platform holder is innovation. And with this, we know that innovation takes 2 forms, one driven by us and the other driven by the software development community. One truly innovative concept that we first presented to the world on this stage last year is iToy. Developed by our sister company, Sony Computer Entertainment Europe, iToy is a revolutionary USB camera that allows the users to really become part of the gaming experience for the first time by projecting their images directly onto the screen. It also introduced a new user interface that is not reliant on the standard controller. iToy was released only 10 short months ago, and since this time, we have shipped more than 3.8 million units worldwide. This demonstrates the insatiable appetite consumers have for something new and something different. It also shows us that our audience embraces new types of gaming experiences And through its release, iToy has challenged creators to think about the market differently. This experimentation has launched a variety of iToy applications. We have a series of products that extend the original iToy experience, like the original Play, Groove, and Sing. In addition, more and more developers are incorporating iToy functionality into existing games, like the recently released MLB 2005 from our own internal sports team. And now we're seeing a new 3D game experience taking off using iToy and its motion tracking technology. We're extremely excited by the growth and interest in iToy, and many titles are currently in development from our first-party studios around the world. Along with first-party support, we have seen significant interest from the third-party community as the iToy user base continues to grow. Some of the products you will see at E3 that support iToy are the new Harry Potter game from Electronic Arts, Dance Dance Revolution from Konami, and Sega Superstars from Sega. We believe that hardware innovations like iToy are important for the growth of this industry. And because initiatives like iToy have helped to bring in new users on a wider scale, like kids and families, we know that encouraging innovation will ultimately be one of the key cornerstones of the platform's success and a key differentiator from our competitors. Because of the overall interest in this type of entertainment, online-enabled content is becoming a standard in our industry. This content must keep up with the expanding consumer expectations, and online game development will play a key role in moving from one generation to the next. This includes both the in-home console market and the mobile gaming space. This slide outlines our overall online adoption curve since the introduction of the network adapter in 2002. To date, we have 3 million online-ready consoles in the market, which is currently more than 10% of our installed base. The 10% figure was a lifetime goal that we had set for ourselves, and the fact that we have been able to achieve this in less than 2 years is nothing short of astonishing. Our online community has surpassed all expectations to achieve critical mass in record time with more than 1.2 million registered connected consoles. The more impressive fact is that we have been experiencing an uptake of about 100,000 new users a month, even during periods when new content was being introduced. And to put this in context, it's like adding a full stadium of people at the Rose Bowl to the PlayStation 2 online community on a monthly basis. These figures lead us to believe that 2004 is a growth year for online gaming on PlayStation 2. Not only do we believe that the best online content is developed for PlayStation 2, we know that our online library is the most diverse and genre balanced, which will help us achieve the ultimate goal of reaching the casual gamer market. In fact, by year end, we will have more than 100 online titles on PlayStation 2. And as the number of titles released on PlayStation 2 each year has remained constant, the portion of titles offering online capabilities has nearly doubled year over year. So, now let's take a look at some of this great online content. Thank you. And now it's my pleasure to introduce one of the best developers in the business with whom we have had the pleasure of working very closely for many, many years. Here to further demonstrate how we plan to reach out to the casual gamer through online content, please give a warm welcome to the president and CEO of Insomniac Games, Ted Price.
Thank you very much, Kaz. And before we get started, I'd like to give you all a quick taste of Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal, the newest in the Ratchet & Clank franchise.
Thank you.
Two years ago, the original Ratchet & Clank debuted right here as one of the first real evolutions in action platforming in years. Since then, the original and its successor, Ratchet & Clank Going Commando, have sold close to 4 million copies worldwide. This E3, though, we're showing off what we think is the next step in action platforming. Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal is the first online action platformer for the PlayStation 2. Now, this game is really two games in one. It's a huge single-player game, as big as either of its predecessors, and a full-featured online game. Today, I'll be talking about the online features and explaining why we think it will help expand the online market for the PlayStation 2. Now, when we started developing Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal, we had three goals. The first was to become an online developer. And now, like most developers out there, we've been developing single-player games since our start 10 years ago. We knew that to compete in today's market, we would have to make the leap to online and do it very quickly. Fortunately, with Sony's help, we were able to do it in a matter of months. Our second goal, create two great tastes that taste great together. Chocolate, peanut butter, you know, whoever thought that would work, right? Well, for us, it was online and action platforming. Put them together, create something completely unique. Furthermore, when we started looking at what was out there on online, we realized that most of the games are very realistic. Most of the games take themselves really seriously. We asked ourselves, where's the humor in online games? Where are the farm animals? Nobody's doing it. The third goal we had, create more network adopters. Let's broaden the online market by bringing online to a new audience. Consumers who play games like Ratchet & Clank, action platformers, these players are less likely to have made the jump to online than any other market segment. Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal brings these players into the online family. Now let's talk a little bit about the features for Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal. We've got six big battlefields, two of which we're showing off here at E3. The game is peer-to-peer, and we can play eight players at a time. For those who don't have network adapters, we also support split-screen, so you can play against three of your friends at home. Furthermore, we're offering strong community support. We've got a full-featured online lobby with all the bells and whistles you'd expect to see from a dedicated online game, features like clans, buddy lists, stat tracking, password-protected games. Furthermore, we're also supporting real-time voice chat with the Sony headset. Eight players can be speaking at a time, and we will run at a consistent 60 frames per second. Now, this is a first for the PlayStation 2. Now, as far as the online modes go, we're offering Siege Mode, Capture the Flag, Deathmatch, and in a few seconds, we'll be showing off Siege Mode, where we'll also demonstrate co-op vehicles, destructible environments, and the very cool weapons and gadgets that make up the Ratchet universe. And yes, you can turn your friends into sheep online. So I would like to start things off by introducing our players, all from Insomniac Games. First, the red team. Brian Hastings, our vice president of programming. Scott Reeser, online programmer. Eric Christensen, our director of gameplay. And Sam Christensen, online programmer. On the blue team, Brian Allgaier, our design director. Corey Stockton, our online designer who kicks my ass every single time I play this game. Eric Ellis, online programmer. and Doug Finch, our QA manager. All right, guys, you set? All right, let's start. Okay, so what we got going on here is red versus blue. Red is trying to take the blue base. Blue is trying to take the red base. Now, we've started the battle in mid-battle because these battles are big and they can take a long time. What they're trying to do right now is take nodes. When you take a node, you actually give yourself team an advantage because if you die, you can respawn at a node. Furthermore, you can see that we've got vehicles operating here. We've got, we've got guys using the different weapons. We've got different skins going on in the game. This vehicle right here is the hover ship. It's one of our two vehicles we're offering. What's great about the hover ship is that you can take out destructible environments and you can carry passengers. So what he's doing right now, I think, is about to drop off one of his buddies. Actually, he's trying to kill this guy right here. And this player over here has the slingshot. This is a very cool gadget that we offer. It's from the Ratchet & Clank universe. But as you can see, using gadgets in this game is very important. We've got magna boost, ramps like this that you can walk up and down. This guy is destroying one of our bridges. This gives his team a significant advantage over the other team. See what we also got here. This player here has just taken a node. Looks like he's going to be heading towards the blue base on his own. Now it's important to remember that you can't take a base by yourself. You definitely need friends, but he's going to try to do it anyway. What's important to note about the bases is that they're very well defended. We've got automated turrets, drones, what we call ball bots who will come after you and kill you. And anyway, it looks like the blue team has the advantage here. They have more nodes. Blue team is taking advantage of the red team by trying to snipe them from hidden spots here. Now, the more nodes you get, the more your team has an advantage because the other team will have to be spawned at their base and try to go all the way back to your base. This player right here is trying to turn his friend into a sheep. There we go. The first sheep in the game. If you turn into a sheep, you can actually respawn as a player if you stay away from the other characters. Here we got a character who's who's taking advantage of the magna boots. One of the great things about using the magna boots is you can stand on the ceiling and take out the turret from afar. Let's see. The blue team is trying hard to take the red base, but as you can see, the defenses are pretty tough. These big Gatling guns will take out your health very quickly. This player here, the Ratchet, is using his different weapons. We've got a lot of different weapons that we offer. He's using the N60 machine gun, trying to take out the ball turrets. Now we've got a bunch of red guys here around the blue base who are actually doing a little bit worse than the red guys who are at the blue base. All they've got to do is take out one more turret, and then they can take the base. All you have to do is take out all the turrets and step on the teleporter. So it looks like all you have to do is step on the teleporter, and they win. So congratulations to Blue Team. Well done. Congratulations to both the team, Red and Blue. Thank you, guys. So I hope you all enjoyed that. We have that kind of mayhem going on at our offices constantly. But as you can see, Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal is a very cool combination of online and action platforming. And we think that it will expand the online market for the PlayStation 2 and once again take the action platforming genre in a brand new direction. So please come by the Sony booth. We'll be playing Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal for the entire show and hosting online games, and you can turn your friends into sheep. Thank you very much.
I'd like to thank Ted Price and the folks at Insomniac Games for that great presentation on Ratchet & Clank Up Your Arsenal. In general, we feel that we're headed in the right direction, leading the online gaming charge. And we believe that we have learned a lot along the way. But with anything, we must evolve the experience. Again, we see innovation on two fronts, driven by us, the platform holder, and by the creative community. So far, the content is there for users to experience and enjoy, but in general, without the community. Right now, non-revenue generating head-to-head gameplay is the norm, but not for long. We believe that the biggest potential driver for future growth is threefold: community building, commerce, and customization. As we move forward, one thing must remain constant, and that is control. And by control, I mean control from the content creator standpoint that includes the ability to retain their customer base, their IP, and customer relationship without mandates or interference from us. Control is also important from the general consumer point of view. We see community development in two ways, managed by the platform holder and managed by the publishers and developers. The natural formation is game-based communities. The next step is facilitating communication between those groups in a natural way. Our goal is to foster platform-wide community encompassing them all. Travelers cross borders between friendly states, each with their own customs and characters. But we are not deviating from our strategic approach and philosophy. The content creator makes the most important choices and controls its own destiny. Our new approach allows for shared consumer data options, and we will be offering a flexible solution for hosting for those that need it or require it. A billing system is also under development as well, and we can guarantee a secured network through the DNAS solution that we have already established. The main thing with our new approach is that all of this will be seamless to the end user. Another big area of concern for the industry at large is how to make money in the online space. In fact, many believe that this is the only thing holding online gaming back from becoming a true mass market proposition. One factor that motivates consumers is price or cost of entry. Our research shows us that consumers expect head-to-head play for free, and in fact, state that a fee-based structure is the main barrier to entry. We believe that the way to monetize online gaming is through mini transactions. We can substantiate this statement by looking at what's happened with digital music downloads. The music industry did not prepare itself for the future, a future that included the proliferation of online consumer usage. The music industry was almost destroyed by illegal music downloads. Then, Apple entered the business and presented a business model based on mini transactions that the consumers would be willing to pay for. But this is not the music industry. In games, our core is based on the latest technology practices, and I don't believe that our industry is structured to allow an outsider to pave a pathway to the future. Innovation and direction will always come from within. We view a future where small transactions are the norm, not just between consumers and content creators, but also among consumers themselves. We can make a fundamental shift by recognizing that the time a user puts into gaming has value. For example, a new player with money, but not time, could buy a Gran Turismo car that's been loaded and tweaked from an experienced player who's no longer playing. In order to bring this to reality, we need to be able to offer the hardware to support it. We released the internal 40-gigabyte hard disk drive for PlayStation 2. And in addition, we are currently investigating a non-HDD contingent solution for PlayStation 2. So, in summary, we know that consumer acceptance is there for online gaming. And in fact, as I said before, we're seeing an online uptake on PlayStation 2 around 100,000 new users per month. And to satisfy this demand, we know that supplying the best online content and an expanded community functionality will not only drive the market, but keep users engaged in online play, further extending the reach and shelf life of any online product. And to that end, we plan to increase our support for our business partners to ensure that they have flexible options for their online game plans while still allowing them control to their business and manage their franchises as they see fit. We know through our platform plans that the online evolution and game development will be a critical path towards building a bridge from this platform to the next. And most important, we believe that revenue generated from online content will be a reality in this life cycle, and we have the right plan to move the industry in the right direction. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the latest addition to the PlayStation family. Thank you. Why is PlayStation Portable so important at this stage in the game? After building tremendous equity in the home console space, we began to look at the mobile market. We waited to introduce a product at the right time, and we believe the timing now is right. The proliferation of mobile devices is at an all-time high. And in fact, many of us carry around more than one device. Today, the worldwide market for mobile devices, whether it be cell phones, digital music devices, productivity tools, and gaming machines, is more than 1.4 billion units worldwide. PlayStation Portable will enter an already crowded space, but one with much growth opportunities. So, what is PlayStation Portable? It is a handheld video game system that offers 3D CG games incorporating high-quality, full-motion video similar to PlayStation 2. PlayStation Portable is as revolutionary as PlayStation, but in different ways. And PlayStation Portable is a brand new format and a brand new business for us. It is a totally new play experience. It incorporates new technologies like curved surfaces and wireless connectivity. It requires new titles design methodologies. It will entice new consumers, perhaps some new to gaming. And it will present new opportunities. PlayStation Portable will allow consumers to enjoy 3D gaming similar to the experience delivered on PlayStation 2. It also has the ability to deliver high-quality movies, music, and video, as well as other forms of digital entertainment content through one central device. It is based on a new optical disc medium developed by Sony called Universal Media Disc, or UMD. It incorporates wireless technology that will allow for new types of consumer interaction while gaming, as well as a multitude of opportunities for downloadable entertainment content, a first in this industry. And all of this is made possible through cutting-edge technologies aimed at helping us explore the future in new ways. The initial target audience for PSP is more reminiscent of our approach in the home console space. We will be looking at a primary target of 18 to 34-year-old males, and those users more apt to embrace new technologies and products early on. This group is one of the largest on PlayStation 2, and we know that they buy more games with more disposable income. The secondary target is the teen market, and this audience is bigger, more diverse, and more complex than ever before. PlayStation Portable is designed to take entertainment on the go. As you can see, it is black with the majority of the real estate taken up by a beautiful LCD display. The product dimensions are 170 millimeters long, 74 millimeters high, and 23 millimeters deep. In total, it weighs 260 grams. And as I mentioned, the screen is one of the product's key features and it is very different from what is currently on the market. It is 4.3-inch wide TFT LCD widescreen. The aspect ratio is 16:9. This enhances the in-game peripheral vision and enables the same kind of situational awareness one would have on a high-resolution display. One area of some discussion has been the amount of onboard memory, so I am pleased to announce that PlayStation Portable will have 32 megabytes of main memory and 4 megabytes of embedded DRAM. PlayStation Portable has built-in stereo speakers. It includes onboard ports for headphones, microphone, controllers, power, and battery recharge. UMD is a delivery medium, and we will accommodate both regional and parental access controls. So here's a look at PlayStation Portable's main input-output areas. First is the wireless port. We plan to support the IEEE 802.11b standard for wireless local area network usage. 802.11b is one of the most efficient ways to connect wireless devices, including the PC, to the internet and to each other at a very high speed. And it will have profound implications for a world bent on anytime, anywhere communication. We plan to support USB 2.0 and Memory Stick Duo Pro, which will make it easy for consumers to upload and download content between each other and devices between, for example, the PC. PlayStation Portable will have an IRDA or infrared data port, and an IR remote using Sony's CIRC standards. Battery and battery life are key aspects for portable gaming. PlayStation Portable will have a lithium-ion battery. Made of lithium, lithium-ion batteries are much lighter and ideal for mobile devices. They have the longest operating life without having to be recharged. So what is the battery life going to be on PlayStation Portable? It will be on par with traditional handheld systems, or approximately 10 hours. It is comparable to an HDD-based portable music player, or approximately 8 hours. Or it'll be comparable to portable DVD players, which in many cases is about 2.5 hours. We are planning for a wide range of peripherals for PlayStation Portable. Some you may expect, and other non-conventional items. Some of the standard peripheral plans include a stand, remote controller, headphones, battery pack, carrying case, and of course a strap. Other new items that will be a first on PlayStation Portable are a USB camera, GPS systems, and a keypad, all custom designed for the product. UMD is set to become a new global format, one that can be used in many future products, including PlayStation Portable. UMD is a large capacity optical disc medium specifically designed by Sony with PlayStation Portable in mind. And in fact, its storage capacity is 3 times that of a CD-ROM. This format is the perfect solution to delivering high-quality CD games, movies, music, and many other forms of digital entertainment. It will come with lower manufacturing costs, which will ultimately minimize inventory risk and allow for a more progressive business model. And as with any initiative from Sony Computer Entertainment, games, great games, are viewed as the most important application. This is how we view PlayStation Portable for the very best games, now portable play on the go. The difference that PlayStation Portable makes is now that we have the ability to bring modern 3D console experience to a mobile platform. We're very excited about this opportunity, and this enthusiasm is shared by many in the industry. It was important to make PlayStation Portable very easy to develop for, to encourage the types of support that consumers have come to expect with PlayStation products. The development environment is based on OpenGL-like graphics API and a robust compiler. In the past, we've seen new systems with greater power, but at the price of higher development costs. The opposite is happening with PlayStation Portable. The power and ease of development puts developers in this incredible sweet spot because they are going to be able to deliver true console-like experiences without high-end console development expenses. And because of this, we are seeing a lot of variation in PlayStation Portable games even now. The key product drivers rest in four areas. First is the development of original intellectual properties. Second is the extension of existing PlayStation franchises reborn in new and in different ways. The third is the ability to leverage the equity built into PlayStation 2 products for interoperability between our home console and PlayStation Portable. And finally, not to be undervalued, is the advent of wireless gaming and all of the possibilities that this may bring to the market. We view our world as one with a connected future. This includes the ability to connect PlayStation Portable to many other platform devices like PlayStation 2, other PSP units, and the PC. These abilities offer some really exciting possibilities for games and the gaming market. As with our home consoles, we're fortunate to have support from all of the best companies in the business on PlayStation Portable. This includes 34 companies from Japan, like Konami, Capcom, Namco, and Bandai. 24 companies from North America, like Electronic Arts, Activision, THQ, and Take-Two. 31 companies from Europe, like Ubisoft, Atari, and Codemasters. 10 companies from South Korea, like Axis Entertainment and Nexon. And of course, from all of the Sony Computer Entertainment development studios worldwide. So, let's take a look at some of the fruits of their labor. We're gonna switch and flip so we get the hits that'll make you move your hips. In line with the funky rhyme, and the people say we're gonna lose our mind. Thank you. And now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce a man and a business partner from one of the industry's most prominent publishers who has joined us on stage on several occasions in the past. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to the president of Electronic Arts Worldwide Studios, Don Mattrick.
Thank you, Kaz. Good morning, everyone. Since the launch of the PlayStation 1, SCEA and Electronic Arts have formed one of the most powerful partnerships in the entertainment industry. When PlayStation 2 launched in 2000, EA supported it with six games, including Madden NFL and SSX. By the end of that first year, we had a 40% market share, and we never looked back. We consider that achievement to be the reflection on our commitment to Sony. PlayStation 2 showed us how important great content is to the launch of any new hardware. And Sony has always understood it's all about great software. When PlayStation Portable debuts next year, EA will provide the same degree of support that we gave the PlayStation 2. We've committed the resources and the people to make the PlayStation Portable a huge success. Right now, more than 100 of EA's best engineers, designers, and artists are doing early work for this system. When PlayStation Portable debuts next spring, EA will have a minimum of 4 titles supporting the launch. These titles include NBA Street, NFL Street, Tiger Woods PGA Tour Golf, and Need for Speed Underground. Everyone at EA is excited about the look and feel of these games. I want to show you some footage that captures early code run on a PC architecture. The emulator we're using is based on early specifications that Sony released in their public statements about the PlayStation Portable. I think you're going to be impressed. The super sharp graphics and 16:9 aspect ratio give these games a look that I think will soon be identified with the PlayStation Portable. Let's take a look. Before I leave, I want to thank Kaz, Kutaragi-san, and all the people at Sony Computer Entertainment. Every year, you make gaming more fun.
Thank you, Don. Thank you. Mr. Don Matrick. A special thanks to Don for joining us here today. And we look forward to hearing and seeing all of EA's titles on PlayStation Portable in the very near future. As I mentioned, UMD is a really unique format specifically designed to accommodate digital entertainment needs through PlayStation Portable. We view games as the killer application for this product. But part of the process of establishing a new global format is encouraging support from a variety of entertainment partners. The gaming companies have definitely showed us the way by their overwhelming support for PlayStation Portable. But we have also received interest from other major entertainment partners outside of games that see the overall market potential. This support includes movie studios and music labels. Part of the attraction is their confidence in our ability to make PlayStation Portable a success to the level that we have done with our home consoles. And we have guaranteed an open profile policy and licensee model to encourage their support. And now we would like to show you demonstrations of UMD content from some of our content partners. The first demo comes from our sister company, Sony Pictures Entertainment. You might have heard that they're planning to release a new Spider-Man feature film next month. Here is one of their latest movie trailers for Spider-Man 2 running on PlayStation Portable.
I believe there's a hero in all of us. Gives us strength, makes us noble. Even though sometimes we have to give up the thing we want the most.
Parker!
Where you been? Looking for you all morning?
You're late.
Always late!
You're fired!
Look at you, Peter. Your grades have been declining. You always appear exhausted.
I know, I'm trying.
So where you been, pal? You don't return my calls.
I've been kind of busy.
Taking pictures of your friend.
Spider-Man
killed my father.
No matter what I do.
Do you love me or not?
No matter how hard I try.
I want Spider-Man dead.
It's the ones I love who will always be the ones who pay.
I can't keep thinking about you. I'm getting married.
I want a life of my own. And Spider-Man. No more.
You look different.
I let things get in the way before. There was something I thought I had to do. I don't have to.
I like seeing you tonight, Peter.
Now on to the main event.
Octavius is going to put Oscorp on the map in a way my father never even dreamed of.
Crazy scientist turns himself into some kind of a monster. Four mechanical arms welded right onto his body.
Who takes Spider-Man's pictures? Where is he?
You're taking me off your loyalty to Spider-Man and not to your best friend. Bring Spider-Man to me.
How do I find him?
Peter Parker.
Find Spider-Man, or I'll peel the flesh off her bones.
There are bigger things happening here than...
The story continues June 30th.
Spider-Man 2, ladies and gentlemen. The next UMD video demo comes from our long-standing partner, Square Enix. Yesterday, Square Enix announced an exciting new development in the world's most powerful franchise, Final Fantasy. Final Fantasy Advent Children is a fully developed visual entertainment sequel to Final Fantasy VII, the seminal 1997 PlayStation hit. Through more than 70 minutes of beautifully crafted content, Final Fantasy Advent Children revisits the universe of memorable characters of Final Fantasy VII 2 years after its dramatic conclusion. Square Enix announced that Final Fantasy Advent Children is coming to DVD, and now we're pleased to have this as part of our UMD video family. So, let's take a sneak peek at Final Fantasy Advent Children.
The planet weaves a cruel fate for men. Children are always the first to suffer. Geostigma. Genova. Reunion. Children who have lost hope. Respite for the soul. And so he takes sword in hand once again.
Thank you.
C7. Advent Children.
I'd like to thank Square Enix for providing us with this content to share with you all this morning. The UMD format also offers some exciting and interesting possibilities for the music industry. In addition to digital music distribution, UMD will allow artists to package and distribute all types of content, fusion of music and video through PlayStation Portable. The next demo was provided by Sony Music Entertainment. It is a video from one of the hottest alternative bands in the market today, Incubus. They just released a new album, so let's take a look at one of Incubus's latest videos running on PlayStation Portable. Incubus, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see, the possibilities are endless. In addition to packaged media, we're also considering extending Sony Kinect's digital music service to PlayStation Portable users. Launched last week, Sony Kinect will be first available on PlayStation Portable in the United States. Please allow me to extend a special word of thanks to Sony Pictures Entertainment, Square Enix, Sony Music Entertainment, and Incubus for those great demonstrations. The PlayStation Portable release schedule breaks out as follows. Calendar end 2004 target in Japan. Fiscal end release for North America and Europe, or by the end of March 2005, with Korea and other markets thereafter. And we're on track to ship approximately 3 million units of PlayStation Portable by the end of our fiscal year. And for our final segment now, it is my pleasure to introduce my friend and colleague, Chief Technology Officer for Sony Computer Entertainment, Inc., Masa Chatani.
Thank you.
Hey, Masa. Okay.
Thank you, Kaz. Hi, everyone. I'm Masa Chatani, Chief Technology Officer, Sony Computer Entertainment. I'm very pleased to be here today. In March 2001, IBM, Toshiba, and SCE announced the joint development of a super parallel processor for the age of broadband networks. The project is codenamed Cell. Since then, in the design center in Austin, Texas, many architects and engineers have been working hard on day and night to develop innovative Cell processor. Cell processor has burst floating capabilities designed for rapidly increasing computation requirements. Massive data bandwidth is introduced to support huge floating point performance. In addition to this, outstanding performance, parallel processing architecture enables scalable systems for higher performance applications. By bringing supercomputing capabilities to digital entertainment, creation, Sony, SCE, and IBM believe to innovate digital content entertainment with Cell processor. Today, I am very pleased to announce to you that Sony, SCE, and IBM have agreed to develop our Cell processor-based workstation. The workstation will fully use the supercomputing performance of the Cell processor. The workstation aimed for digital content creation and application is the first computing application announced for the Cell processor. Now, let me introduce our key person from IBM, Mr. Bob Hansen. Bob, please stand up. Thank you. Bob is the project lead of Cell processor-based workstations at IBM since we started this project. IBM, Sony, and SCE will continue to work together to keep bringing innovations into the digital content creation. Our objective is to provide supercomputing for various digital entertainment applications. For digital content creation, there are so many techniques that require vast floating point capabilities. Modeling, rendering, physics simulation are some of the well-known techniques. Physics simulation changed racing game by calculating the precise motion of cars. By synthesizing real images with computer-generated facial expressions, totally new images are created in movies. Imagine a movie scene of a thousand of people on the battlefield. Their autonomous behaviors are all generated by algorithms. The demand for computation is unlimited. Particularly, demand for floating point capability is skyrocketing, and it will differentiate the quality of the content. For various types of development and techniques shown here, a common development is the most desired by creators. It is essential to integrate various computation on a single workstation. To achieve this goal, our collaboration covers a wide range of content development environment. It is from cell-based hardware, workstation hardware, to application including other layers in between. IBM empowers this project with technology and know-how accumulated over the years in the workstations. IBM is to develop cell processor-based workstations as key systems for digital content creation. Sony SCE will bring our assets and experiences in digital content creation of movies and games. More importantly, Sony and SCE will lead the innovation of the common development environment, including real-time OS, middleware, tools, and applications for digital content creation. Computer-generated images are commonly seen in movies and as well as games. Modeling, animation, character, and scene creation are primary objectives in the creation of computer-generated images. Common development environment running on cell-based workstation offers a flexible and dynamic environment for the, content creation. The technologies for creating movies and games have become closer. The common development environment with cell-based workstation will benefit the content creators in various stages of development process. In addition to the effectiveness of development, the supercomputing capability to create digital content will push the quality of the content much higher than that of today. In game development, programming, authoring, simulation, and interaction development are the key objectives. Unlike non-real-time content, interaction design, such as control of gameplay, becomes one of the important elements in creating real-time content. For the game development of our next generation entertainment system, SCE will introduce a cell-based game development system. Cell-based game development system will be the main tool for programmers. The system has dedicated architecture for targeted game platform. Cell processor-based workstation shares common development environment with game development systems. Thanks to the common development environment, cell-based workstations will help games game development for massive computation tasks like physics simulation and encoding and authoring of video content. Now we envision a couple years from now, games and movies will converge to create totally new form of entertainment. It will be different from what we know as games or movies today. When movies and games are created, the data of the world for games and movies are constructed and stored on the cell-based workstation. When multiple cell-based systems are connected to the broadband network, cell-based system will form a single cyber world. In the cyber world of cell-based systems, citizens, vehicles, buildings, and the cities are generated and operated by multiple cell systems connected through broadband networks. Cell-based next-generation entertainment system is also a part of the cyber world. User will jack in to the cyber world through the entertainment system in the home. And user will be able to navigate the cyber world seamlessly. This is a future of broadband entertainment. I have one last important news for you. The first prototype of cell-based workstation is coming in the fourth quarter of 2004. We are committed to innovate digital entertainment with cell-based content development environment. Today's announcement is the beginning of a huge paradigm shift triggered by cell processors. We believe that it is go beyond borders of digital entertainment to revolutionize technology and business in the future. So everyone, please look forward to what's waiting for you in the very near future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Masa. Thank you. I'd like to thank Masa for being here today to share some of our plans for the next generation in computer entertainment. And I would like to thank all of you for joining us here today, this morning. As you can see, we have a lot of really new and exciting things in store for the future. But please, don't take my word for it. Please feel free to stop by our booth to experience the new dimensions of PlayStation for yourselves. Thank you, and have a great show.